Well, good morning, folks. This is Brother Dan, and this is a word for Sunday, January 17th, 2021. Now, next Sunday, we're going to get back together in church on the 24th, so just be aware of that and be reminded of that. Earlier this week, I was listening to the radio, Dr. Jack Graham out in Prestonwood, Texas, and he was talking about a passage in Matthew 21 about Jesus speaking to mountains, and it was about faith and belief in the Lord, and Jesus was dealing with his disciples. And so I want to talk to you today about speaking to mountains. Now, the text that I'm taking out of Matthew 21 is a chapter where the Lord Jesus Christ is facing his most difficult week of his entire life. We're talking about the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. We're talking about where he went into the temple and he overturned the tables. And we're going to pick up now in verse 18 of that chapter the next morning. Now listen to the Bible, Matthew 21 and verse 18. Now in the morning, as he returned to the city, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it but leaves. And he said to it, "Let no fruit grow on you ever again." And immediately the fig tree withered away. Now, when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, "How did the fig tree wither away so soon?" So Jesus answered and said to them, "Assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you not only will do what was done to the fig tree, but also," now listen to this, "if you say to the mountain, 'Be removed and cast into the sea,' it will be done. And all things, whatever you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive." Heavenly Father, help us to hear from your word today by your Holy Spirit, so that we might live lives of great faith, believing what you say to us in your word, and so conducting our lives in obedience that brings you honor and glory as we fulfill your purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're talking about mountains today, and mountains are very interesting. There are some mountains that come into our life that are in our pathway that are simply insurmountable. I'm thinking about that, and I'm thinking not only that they're insurmountable, that we don't have the ability to climb over these mountains in our own strength. I mean, to think of it this way, we're compelled to depend upon the Lord when we face circumstances in our life where we just have to cry out to him, "God, if you don't fix this, if you don't do this, then I'm not going to make it." Oh, that's a good place to be. It's not always a very comfortable place to be. And I don't know, maybe you've been through some things this week, or maybe you're facing circumstances in your life that are just so difficult that they are beyond your ability. They're out of your control. Oh, that's the time, my friend, to call out and cry out unto the Lord. Now, the first mountain I want us to speak to today is the mountain of unbelief. Back in Matthew chapter 19, there's really an interesting passage. It's the passage about the rich young ruler. Matthew 19, 16 says this, "Behold, one came to him and said, 'Good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I might inherit eternal life?'" I mean, this guy wanted to know what he could do in order to get to heaven. So Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life," listen to Jesus, "keep the commandments." And so the ruler said, "Which ones?" And Jesus said, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and mother." He just goes through a litany of the Ten Commandments. "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said to him, "All these things I've kept from my youth, what do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me." When the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And then Jesus said to his disciples, "Assuredly, I say to you, it's hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I say to you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Now look, we're thinking about the mountain of unbelief. It's a hindrance to eternal life. Now, how do we deal with that mountain? What do we say to that mountain? Verse 25, I'm still in Matthew 19. When his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed. And they said, who then can be saved? But Jesus looked at them and said to them, with men, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Listen, it takes the Lord Jesus Christ in order to remove this mountain of unbelief. If you're a person that has not yet trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, there's not anything that you can do good in order to merit salvation. You must trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus says it right here. With men, this is impossible. To answer the question, who then can be saved? With men, it's impossible. It's impossible for men to be saved. Salvation is only possible when you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, removing that mountain of unbelief. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, is the promise of Scripture. Well, so we dealt with the first mountain of unbelief. Do we have any other mountains? Man, you better believe it. And I don't have to tell you that because you already know all the troubles that you go through in life. Let's just look at another mountain. These are just some things that occurred to me that I picked out that are mountains. What about the mountain of the circumstances that are against you? What I'm asking is, are you ever disappointed? This is the dumbest question I've ever asked in my life. Are you ever disappointed in life? Do things occur that disappoint you, that things don't go like you want them to go? Judges 6:13 is a verse that I just love this verse. We're talking about the mountain of circumstances. Look, I want to say to these circumstances, be removed. I want God to deal with this because I can't deal with it. This is Gideon in Judges chapter 6. Here's the Bible. Gideon said to him, oh my Lord, if the Lord is with us, how many times have you asked this question? Why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his miracles, which our fathers told us about, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. Let me tell you what a mountain of disappointment looks like. It looks like to you, if you look at it with your eyes, with human viewpoint, it looks like something that's just completely insurmountable, that something that you can do nothing about. And worse than that, in the depth of your mind, you're thinking about, God has really kind of abandoned me. That's what Gideon says. I mean, he says, where are all the miracles? What, you know, he's asking God, why has the Lord forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of men? Why, God, are you letting all these circumstances go on? Well, you know the whole story, how God delivered Gideon. And God made sure that Gideon and everybody knew that the deliverance came from God. When God delivered Gideon from those Midianites. I'm telling you, when you speak to that mountain of circumstances, when you're disappointed in life, you're speaking in the name of the Lord. Lord, you're going to have to take care of these circumstances. You're going to have to remove this mountain. And what you need to do is simply wait on the Lord and let him work through it. Now, here's a little caveat. You can take all that stuff into your own hands and try to fix it yourself, and you'll make it worse. You'll make it worse. You better depend on the Lord to deliver you. Hey, he delivered me from the mountain of unbelief. I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And I cannot think in my life, looking back, any circumstances that God did not deliver me from as I waited upon him. Even this week, he'll deliver you from your circumstances in his time. And while you're waiting for that deliverance, keep speaking to that mountain and God will take care of you. All right, here's another mountain that you might face. What about the mountain of relationships? We all have relationships in our family, people we deal with. Come on, we're being honest here. When you get a word from Sunday from me, you get honesty. I promise you that. What about, do you ever have trouble with people in your life? Sure you do. Everybody does. I'm thinking about the parable. We talked about the rich young ruler. We're talking about riches. What about the rich man? This is in Luke chapter 12. And there's a wonderful parable there. And I just want to read you some of those verses. Verse 13 of Luke 12 says, then one from the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." In other words, this guy's having a problem with his brother, and he wants Jesus to fix it. And he wants Jesus to fix it like the way he wants it to be fixed. I'm telling you, a lot of times we have trouble with relationships. Oh boy, I'm touching a live wire here. I hope it gets to some of us. When we're dealing with relationships, we need to look in the mirror first. I mean, I know that. I know I need to look within myself. Am I trying by manipulation or persuasion or whatever to get my way, failing to take into consideration the most important consideration, which is what's God's will in this situation? What does God want? I'm back to Luke 12 to this guy that wants, you know, I want the money. I want, tell my brother to give me that money. And Jesus says in the very next verse, one's life does not consist in the abundance of things he possesses. At the very end of that passage, he says this in verse 21. So he who lays up treasure for himself, so is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Now look, there are mountains within our life that we want to deal with. Now, I said the mountains of relationships. You know what I'm really saying? You know what my biggest mountain is in my life? It's me. I'm the biggest mountain in my life, and that's the mountain I need God to remove. God, remove me, get me out of the way so that you can work and so that you can do what you wish to do with me. That's the mountain that we need to remove in relationship. Now, I tell you what, if you'll let God work out that first relationship by believing on him, then he'll take care of all your circumstances. He'll make them useful to him and you to make you more like Christ. And then he'll work out your relationships with other people because you get yourself out of the way. That's the mountain you need to speak to me. That's a great prayer. Lord, remove the flesh, remove the mountain, remove the problem, which is me. I'm looking at it in this smartphone right now, just talking to myself. I'm really talking to you. You guys can listen in, but I'm talking to myself. All right, well, here, let's talk about another mountain. We're talking about a mountain of unbelief, about the mountain of circumstances. We're speaking to them, the mountain of relationships. Hey, let's speak to the mountain of discouragement, because all of us lack courage in our heart, and we get discouraged in our life. And look, when we come to that mountain of discouragement, we can just simply speak to that mountain. I'm talking about practical ways to deal with things going on in our life. It's wonderful and fine and good to say to that mountain of discouragement, in Jesus' name, be removed and cast into the sea. And then have the faith and belief in your heart, in your mind, in your life, that God's going to take care of that. You've heard the saying, attitude is everything. Well, look, discouragement needs to be dealt with by the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. Here's a couple verses from 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Paul is writing a letter to the church there, and he says this to them. For indeed we came to Macedonia. And listen to what Paul was going through. I know you go through a hard time. I know you're discouraged. Do you think Paul was discouraged? He says this, our bodies had no rest. We were troubled on every side. Outside were conflicts. Inside were fears. Nevertheless, God, who comforts the downcast. Let me say that again. God, who comforts the downcast, comforted us by the coming of Titus. Now, in this situation, Titus was a comfort to the folks. And then the Bible goes on to say, and not only by his coming, here's the important part, but also by the consolation which with which he was comforted in you when he told us of your earnest desire, your sorrow, your zeal for me, so that I rejoiced even more. Now here's what to do with discouragement. Say to that mountain, be removed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And while you're saying to that mountain, be removed, then you need to engage yourself in the encouragement of other people. The antidote to discouragement is to encourage other people, like Titus encouraged, like Paul encouraged, not only by his coming, by the consolation with which he was comforted in you. Look, when you encourage other people, you have a blessing, a fountain of encouragement within you that blesses you oftentimes even more. I have this happen to me every week. I run into somebody and I'm just chatting with them. I'm just talking to them. I might have an opportunity to pray with them, and I might have and interestingly, sometimes I'm kind of a little, you know, disappointed, a little bit down, and that person comes along and I realize, hey, their problems are way more than mine. But even within their problems and within their sorrow and trouble and difficulty, you know, God allows me to do an amazing thing. Think about that. A human being bringing encouragement to another person, another human being. And so you pray for them. You encourage them. You tell them you love them. You care for them. And they like that. I've had people cry over that. And I'm walking away and I got tears running down my cheeks because God uses that to encourage me. Say to that mountain of disappointment, be removed. And by the way, while I'm talking to that mountain, I want to talk to some other people to encourage them in their discouragement. All right, here's another mountain. What about distress? Are you ever, here's another dumb question. Hey, do you ever have any stress in your life? I started to say flippantly, no, I don't. Of course I do. We all have stress in our lives. They lead to high blood pressure if you don't watch out. Distress. Say to that stress in your life, in the name of Jesus, you be removed, stress. That stress ain't too hard for God. He can move that mountain of stress or distress, it's called the scripture word for it. I'm talking about the time in Luke where Jesus is with his disciples. And it's the place where Jesus speaks to the wind and the waves. You know that passage, don't you? It's in Luke 8, beginning at verse 22. Listen to these verses. Now it happened on a certain day that he got into the boat with his disciples. And he said to them, let us cross over to the other side of the lake. And they launched out. Oh, things are going so well. We're with the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything's going along smoothly. We're going to take a little boat ride. It's all good. They launched out. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake, and they were filling with water. I mean, this is bad. And the boat's filling up with water, and they were in jeopardy. Now, that's stress. Jeopardy is such a good Bible word in the New King James Translation. They were in jeopardy. And you got a mountain before you that's a stressful mountain. Hey, I'm in trouble here. I'm in jeopardy. Now, what do you do when you come to that situation? You do what these wise disciples did in verse 24. They came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we are perishing. Now, when you're speaking to that mountain of stress, you say to the Lord, Lord, you see this mountain, you see this trouble, you see this stress, and I'm coming to you. I'm bringing it to you. Now, what did Jesus do about it when they were perishing? What does Jesus do when you are perishing? Then he arose and he rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased. The water that was raging, the wind that was blowing stopped. It ceased. That's what the Bible says. And there was a calm. Oh, that's good. I have all this stress, winds and waves. I bring that mountain to the Lord Jesus Christ. I say, Lord, you see this mountain of stress in my life? And Jesus gets rid of it, and there's calm. And then what happens? But he said to them, where is your faith? And they were afraid and marveled, saying to one another, who can this be? For he commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him. Don't you love our perspective that we can look back and we can think about what the Lord Jesus Christ did on behalf of his disciples when they were under great stress and in jeopardy, and they were scared to death, really. And the Lord Jesus Christ said, peace, be still. What does the mountain of stress, when you speak to that mountain, be removed? What does that look like? Well, it's really more what it sounds like. It's Jesus saying to your heart, peace, be still, and the calmness that washes over you. That's what that mountain is. Now, let's look at just a couple more mountains. What about the mountain of despair? Okay, we're kind of going down here. Discouragement, yeah, that's bad. Distress is worse, but despair, that's a tough one. Despair is really a lack of hope, or the way I heard this put the other day, instead of hope, a good word for hope is assurance. You know, being assured that God is going to come through. The mountain of despair, Lord, remove this mountain, I'm saying to you in Jesus' name, because it's despair. It's almost like I've lost hope. I don't have any assurance that you're going to come through, God. I love Romans 15:13. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you might abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Your hope comes from the resurrection power of the Holy Spirit that's at work in your life, bringing you joy and peace and assurance from the very Spirit of God himself that he is going to come through. Hope is assurance in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I promise you, when God gives you a word, he's going to come through. He cannot lie. You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ in your despair. Now, here's the last mountain I want you to speak to, and it's the mountain of depression. Now, can a Christian ever be depressed? Some of the greatest preachers in the history of preaching and Bible study and scholars, I mean, these guys were just so well rehearsed in all of the things of Scripture, and yet they found themselves to be in depression. Now, before I talk about this, let me just give you a little side note here that's not really a side note. You may need to go get a physical. I mean, there may be some blood work they can look at, and I don't know, serotonin and dopamine and all. I don't know nothing about all that. Some of that might be out of balance. You may need a physical. So we're not discounting that. But we're talking about in the depths of sorrow, sadness, despair, disappointment, discouragement, and all those put together kind of equals depression. What are we going to do about that when we're depressed? I mean, it's almost an inability to function. Have you ever felt that way where, I just can't do it. I mean, I'm just so downcast, I cannot do it. Now, what did the psalmist say? You know, I found this verse. I mean, we all know it's there. We just need to find it in the Psalms. It's Psalm 42 at verse 11. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Those two questions are answered immediately. Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. The very next chapter, Psalm 43, repeats that verse exactly. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. You ever seen somebody that was depressed? Boy, they look bad. Their countenance is downcast. And the answer to that mountain is hope in God and the absolute certainty that there is a time coming that you're going to praise God again, because the psalmist said, yet I shall praise him. Now, you can decide in the depths of that depression when you want to praise him. You can wallow around in self-pity. You can worry about your circumstances. You can try to figure out a way to fix it, or you can start praising God. Listen, there's something just special about praise. Now, I don't do a lot of exercise at all. I get up every morning at 5:30 and I get on the bicycle, and you know what I do? I get on my little smartphone and I put some praise songs on. And I go back to some of those praise songs I used to listen to back in the day, and I just love those praise songs. And what am I doing? I'm letting that praise to the Lord get into my spirit, because it takes my mind off of me and puts the focus on Him, where the focus belongs. Look, we're talking about mountains in our life, and we say to those mountains, be removed. Now, when we read about that, the Bible ends that passage. Jesus said, but also if you say to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, it will be done. Now, just as a little conclusion, a little caveat here, remember that Jesus said in that passage, in all things, whatever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. Just keep in mind, in all of these situations, circumstances, problems, difficulty, distress, disappointment, whatever it is, depression, in all of these things, it's speaking to that mountain in the name of Jesus. It's really kind of a prayer, crying out to God for deliverance, for really the removal of the mountain. But remember to wait on God, because God's at work and all things, whatever you ask in prayer, believing. Make sure your prayer is according to what God wants, and not what you want. Here's a better way, not what I want. Let's make sure it's what God wants. Say to that mountain, be removed, and it'll be cast into the sea. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word. And Lord, what we really thank you for is that we can just read these words, and Lord, we can see them printed on paper, but we want them to come to life, and we want to hear them with a heart of obedience and a heart of belief and trust and faith in you. We know, God, that you're going to come through when we cannot. When we face impossible situations, we're reminded that all things are possible with God. We're reminded, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So, Lord, strengthen us in this time that we're in, and all these mountains that we face. We can't surmount them. They're insurmountable, but they're nothing to you. Just one word from you, you can say, peace, be still, and the calmness will come, and we'll have a smooth path because of what you have done. Thank you is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for listening. Remember, the 24th, a week from today, we'll meet back at Trinity. And if you have any questions, you can send us an email if you want to, tbcheadland@gmail.com, and we'll get back to you. And thank you so much for listening, and may God richly bless you this week.